Ubiquitous in many classrooms since the 19th century, chalk and chalkboards are familiar to most of us. White, powdery, and prone to sticking to those surfaces where it is put, and just as easy to wipe away, chalk and its accompanying board are excellent instructional aids. Notably, however, most chalk today isn't technically chalk at all, but rather gypsum. Chalk and gypsum have both been mined since ancient times. Chalk, calcium carbonate, has been found in cave paintings that date back to 40,000 BC, while gypsum, calcium sulfate, has been used as a mortar for construction since the dawn of civilization and is even found in the Egyptian pyramids. Similar and yet distinct, chalk is a base, an alkali that neutralizes acids, that is composed of calcium and oxygen combined with carbon, while gypsum is a salt, the product of a base and acid reacting and both becoming neutralized, made up of calcium and oxygen combined with sulfur. Both are believed to be formed in a similar fashion. Chalk is a limestone deposit created as plankton, tiny marine organisms, concentrate calcium in their bodies while living, then leach the calcium out after they die and settle onto the ocean floor. Over millennia, large deposits are formed, and as the seas recede, chalk deposits remain. Gypsum's origins are similar, but in addition to being comprised of the calcium produced by the deaths of millions of plankton, gypsum also contains some of the salt that was left behind as the ocean evaporated. Traditionally, chalk has been used for drawing and writing, and by the end of the 18th century, with advances in slate quarrying — slate was originally used for writing tablets and blackboards — writing slates covered with chalk letters, symbols, numbers, and figures were commonplace. Gypsum, on the other hand, had been used primarily in construction, such as for the aforementioned mortar, as well as in the manufacture of windows. Nonetheless, both are susceptible to a process that produces sticks of themselves that, when pressed against certain surfaces, leave washable marks. After quarrying, each is crushed, ground, washed, and sifted. With gypsum, it must also be dehydrated in a process that involves high temperatures to reduce its water content from nearly 21% to about 5-6%. To make classroom chalk, the material is mixed, again, with water and colored pigments if desired, and to produce more exotic pastels, such as used for art drawings, pigments as well as clays or oils are also added. For the former, the chalk is baked, while with the latter, it is air-dried. As to why gypsum has replaced chalk for writing on blackboards, it is commonly suggested it's because chalk is much more dusty. However, modern manufacturing methods, including baking the chalk and coating it with products like shellac, have reduced the problem for both materials. The most likely real reason is that gypsum is used for a huge number of applications, meaning economies of scale kick in a bit more with it being so industrially abundant. The mineral is mined in more than 90 countries, including Canada, Mexico, Spain, and the United States. In the US, 19 states, notably California, Iowa, Nevada, Oklahoma, and Texas, have surface mining operations, and the US alone produces more than 30 million tons of the stuff each year. In fact, in 2013, North American gypsum manufacturers reported sales of gypsum board alone of more than $3 billion annually. Together, they produced more than 20.5 billion square feet of drywall, which is found in more than 97% of American buildings. On that note, sometimes called the rock nobody knows, gypsum can easily be turned into a fine powder by dehydrating it, while it also has the remarkable quality of being one of the only natural substances that can be restored to its original rock-like state by the addition of water alone. Since it can be reconstituted, it can be fashioned into any of a myriad of shapes and modified for various uses. Common applications include plaster of Paris, creating clay molds from which a variety of plastic products are formed, such as plastic cups and plates, the manufacture of glass, as an ingredient in cement and in drywall. This last one has also been a boon to humanity, as gypsum is naturally fire-resistant. Non-toxic, gypsum also pops up in fertilizers and soil conditioners, hair products to make plasters of teeth, to grow mushrooms, brew beer, and bind tofu, which also has the added benefit of making bean curd an excellent calcium source. And now for a bonus fact. Ever wondered why an elephant's nose is called a trunk? Well, want to know more? Naming the elephant nose this first seemed to have happened sometime around the late 16th century. The first documented instance appears in a 1589 work by Richard Hakluyt, Principal Navigations. It reads, "The elephant with water fills his trunk right high and blows it on the rest." As with most etymologies, the precise reason trunk is used to denote an elephant's proboscis is difficult to distinguish with 100% certainty. However, it's generally thought it was because a few decades before trunk started getting applied to an elephant's snout, it was also a word used to describe a pipe or hollow tube, such as a speaking tube or ear trumpet. For instance, in the 1546 John Bale work The Acts of English Voltaires, it reads, "The rude spake these words, or else no monk behind him in a trunk through the wall." Similarly, in the 1553 work by Richard Eden, A Treatise of the New India, which was a translation of Cosmographia by Sebastian Munster, where it describes the tubes used for blowguns. They blow them arrows out of a trunk as we do pellets of clay. This blowgun hollow tube usage particularly fits with the aforementioned first known use of the word to refer to an elephant's proboscis, with water fills his trunk right high and blows it on the rest. Incidentally, another one-time name for the elephant's trunk is boss, presumed to be short for proboscis. This was first attested in the 1594 Lectures on Jonah. It reads, "Curtis writeth of the elephant that he taketh an armed man with his hand. He meaneth the boss of the elephant, which he useth as men their hands." In any event, this might all have you wondering how the trunk of a car got its name. And for the fellow Brits in the audience, just in case you didn't know, that's what Americans call the boot of the car. For this, we need to go back to the Latin truncus, main stem or stock of a tree or human body. This in turn gave rise to the old French tronc around the 12th century, and then the English trunk around the 15th century. It is the main stem of a tree definition that is important in this one. By the mid-14th century, this gave rise to wood chests or cases being referred to as trunks, presumably because they were made from wood and tree trunks. Whatever the case, the first known instance of this definition of the word can be found in a 1462 receipt, Man and House, which reads, "Item paid for a new trunk for my lord, which was delivered to William of Wardrobe, XS." Fast forward a little under half a millennia later, and we find an advertisement in the November of 1929 Hearst International magazine where an automobile is listed as coming standard with six wire wheels and a trunk rack. The rear trunk rack eventually gave way to a built-in storage compartment in the same region of the car that itself was referred to as a trunk in North America. Another interesting one is the use of trunks to refer to an article of clothing, such as swimming trunks or shorts. This general definition of the word seems to have popped up in the 19th century, with the first reference in 1836 in the Pickwick Papers, which reads, "The appearance of Mr. Snodgrass in blue satin trunks and cloak, white silk tights and shoes, and Grecian helmet." As for specifically swimming trunks, we have the first instance appearing in a July of 1883 edition of the Pall Mall Gazette, where it states, "Captain Webb attempted his perilous feat of swimming the Niagara Rapids. He wore a pair of silk trunks." In this case, it is generally thought the definition either stems from the hollow tube idea, with the trunks having two hollow tubes to stick your legs through, hence trunks instead of trunk, or it is referring to the fact that the shorts contain part of the base of the trunk of the body. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below, and don't forget to subscribe. Also, why not check out my podcast? It's called The Brain Food Show. If you search Brain Food, one word, wherever you get your podcasts, you will find it. If you like this show, I think you'll like that podcast as well. And as always, thank you for watching.